What are we doing today? Establishing a new normal. This is our mission. We're the A-team. We have a mission. It's not a mission impossible. It's a mission possible. All right, mission possible. We're working to establish a new normal every day. And our practice is we have assertions we make to help in that way. We have full stop in the wow to let the truth sink into us. And then we have flipping the script, which also helps produce a new normal for us. So this is it. This is the path. Is every day we establish a new normal as we walk back absurdity. Our choice to be absurd, try to be absurd, to try to turn being into absurdity. We have to walk that back. And of course, the continuity fear acts as brakes upon our path. So we have to be patient and we have to work at it every day. It's not as simple as doing it once and that's it. Because of the continuity fear says, whoa, not so fast. I'm kind of used to absurdity. And what is absurdity? Okay, well, what part of truth is absurd? And what part of denying truth is not absurd? And what waiting for absurdity to not be absurd is effective, is not absurd? To wait for absurdity to be not absurd, what part of that waiting is not absurd? And of course, we're talking about time, aren't we? The valuing of time. Waiting for absurdity to not be absurd is the valuing of time. What part of that waiting is not an absurdity? What part of that waiting is not an absurdity? So right away we're into the slipstream, right? Of truth, into the slipstream of truth. Where we're floating along almost effortlessly here, but going fast. Absurdity believes that reason is absurd. Therein lies the trouble here in this world, is when you speak from truth and reason, the world believes you're being absurd. When you say don't value time, for yourself the valuing of time, the world says that's absurd. And they think that you're the one that needs to change. You're the one who's being absurd. And it says, well, it can't be all absurdity can't be absurd. That's absurd to say that. Yes, all of absurdity is absurd. What part of denying truth is not absurd? So this is the walking back. We're walking it back. We walked along with absurdity. Now we're walking it back to truth. Cut and dry. Now I had that dream of this tremendous storm that took place in the world. And I saw it coming and I said, I got to take refuge from this. This is going to be too much trouble. And ultimately, I tried to take refuge under this big tree, which represented just the tradition of this world, religious tradition of this world. It didn't work. So then I had to take some. So this tabletop, a cut tabletop, some stone cut, and it kept me dry. It was black and white tabletop, like granite flecks. So cut and dried, black and white, cut and dried. Is the way to take refuge from the storm that's coming in the world. This is what we're doing here. This is what you and I and all those who want to walk back absurdity are all about here. And absurdity, of course, thinks that if we all agree, if we all are absurd, it's no longer absurd, right? This is the goal of absurdity. Let's all be absurd, and therefore there's no truth at all to say that it's absurd. Okay. Which denies, of course, the creatorship of God, the beingness of God. It's an absurdity. It's like denying, it's like an appearance denying the pure spaciousness in which it is appearing, and saying that there's only the appearance and nothing else. And if we just all believe this, it will be true, because there's nothing to refute it. Well, the pure spaciousness remains. I mean, the nature of reality remains. But absurdity says, no. If we just believe it doesn't remain, then that'll be true. So their goal is to get everyone down the drain of absurdity. And right now, we're all circling that drain. And absurdity says, wonderful, it's we're almost there. We've almost got it. Almost got full consensus, everyone agreeing that everyone being taking an absurdist position. And then when it doesn't work, absurdity, of course, says, well, there's somebody who's not doing it. That's the reason why it's not working. Who is that traitor? Who is that, you know, they scapegoat. Who's that traitor to absurdity? Maybe it's Jesus. Now, Jesus, I've always been extremely ecumenical and taken great pains in my life to strengthen that. I'm truly ecumenical. And what I say about Jesus is that there's no teacher that eclipses Jesus. There is no one who eclipses Jesus. Now, there are other great teachers that shine like Jesus shines, absolutely. But there are no teachers that eclipse Jesus. But nor does Jesus eclipse these other great teachers, all right? But, again, it's an ecumenical way of talking that it is true. But the idea that somehow Jesus is somehow eclipsed in the present absurdist society is simply not true. I absolutely do not accept that in the slightest bit. And they claim, well, that's not being ecumenical. That is absolute nonsense. I'm the most ecumenical presence in the world, I would say. I mean, I have 4 different teachers. I love and respect all of them. They don't eclipse each other. But certainly, they don't eclipse Jesus. That's a fact. That is a fact. And our society now is trying to paint Jesus in a way that is trying to eclipse what he did. And what he did was gave a marvelous example and showcase of the non-valuing of time by his miracles. And this is a great storehouse of treasure. A great treasure storehouse Jesus gave us. He even walked back his own death on the cross. He walked it back. He walked it back and said, even in death, there's no valuing of time. Okay? He cured everything. He did all these miracles. This is an extreme storehouse of treasure. Okay, a great example. It hasn't been eclipsed. Jesus is not eclipsed. All of this testimony and witnessing he did remains a shining example and lesson to all of us. The miracles are important. This is what I'm seeing. Yes, physical miracles are important. Because this is very dramatic, and we say, wow, we thought absurdity has some sort of foothold in reality. And the foothold is this world and bodies. And so we think that some part of absurdity is not absurd. And Jesus pointed out that all of absurdity is absurd. You can't eclipse that. He gave extremely powerful and clear demonstrations that all of absurdity is absurd. And that's exactly the teaching that we need. Have others done this? Yes. Yes. So they're not eclipsable either, right? And neither is Jesus eclipsable. So this way, we do not get pulled into sectarian disagreements, you see? But nor do we lose sight of the great treasure. We don't take our eyes off the prize. That none of absurdity, well, all, let's put it this way, all absurdity is absurd. None of it is not absurd. It does not have a foothold in reality, in truth, at all. And so Jesus dying on the cross, being buried in the tomb, and then arising from the dead and saying, look, I'm perfectly fine. I walked it back. No valuing of time, you see. No part of absurdity is true. This completed his mission here of showcasing the truth. And prior to that, so many, 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 many miracles, healing every manner of affliction, you name it. And they say that if an account of all the miracles he did was written down, it would take an encyclopedia set to write it all down. We just have a brief accounting of it. So, in no way should we allow this great testimony that we have, this great evidence, scientific evidence that we have, to be eclipsed in our minds. And this is what this culture, modern culture, is trying to do. They're relentlessly at it. And they offer us these deals, you know, say, hey, you know, we'll back off Jesus, if you, you know, trying to trash Jesus, if you just accept him as some social activist rabbi. Or that Jesus was just really telling us to do good works, you know. Say hi to your neighbor, you know. If they lose their dog, go help them look for their dog. The cat's on the tree, you help get the cat out of the tree. You know, visit them in the hospital. If they got some, need some food, give them some food. So that's all that Jesus was talking about, they say. That's what they're telling us. That's all that Jesus is about. Do good works, good works, good works. This is what this Pope is emphasizing. No. What we should be emphasizing is the miracles of Jesus. And how did that take place? Because Jesus didn't value time and knew that there is no waiting upon absurdity that is going to make absurdity true at all. So there's no need to wait upon absurdity. Absurdity doesn't have any power at all over reality. And so whatever we want to experience, we can experience it right now. We want this illness to be gone, it's gone right now. We want death to be gone, it's gone right now. Again, what part of the denying truth is not absurd? What part of denying truth is not absurd? Jesus just asked us this question. No, death is denying truth. Everything God creates is eternal. Nothing can die. Okay, so, what part of death, which is a denial of truth, is not absurd? And what part of waiting is going to make it not absurd? So Jesus says, Lazarus, get up from the grave right now. So, this attack on God and truth that absurdity is ceaselessly persecuting and pressing, and the unprecedented extent of it now with mass media, internet, smartphones, television, movies, mass media, you know, everything, the whole mass media stampede, blitzkrieg, is trying to divorce us from Jesus and the great tradition of miracles throughout history, not only from Jesus, but by others too. The great tradition of Christianity with all the miracles, and other traditions too, also. For instance, Tibetan Buddhism, massive tradition of miracles there. Massive. The great Hindu tradition, massive tradition of miracles. Ananda Maimad just had a lifetime of just a parade of miracles. Okay, so this is the great tradition, ecumenical tradition, of all those who have freed themselves, are free of absurdity. and valuing time, completely free of valuing time. They work in a miraculous way. And this is the great tradition. And this, again, this modern culture with its wretched electromagnetic mechanical machine logic, smartness-based absurdity is trying to divorce us from this tradition. So the grace of God is merciful upon the teachers of God and the devotees of truth, as well as all those who are trying to idolize absurdity and helping them turn repent from that. The grace of God is also shines upon the teachers of God here who are trying to help out. And if it gets to be too much trouble here, as it likely will, the grace of God is going to certainly shine blessings upon the teachers of God here and make some adjustments if needed. Because we will not be divorced from the truth and our great tradition that witnesses the scientific evidence throughout history that witnesses to it. They're trying to absolutely submerge that, wipe it out from the history books, from all books, not have it taught anywhere. They want to emphasize just good works, which this present Pope, this Jesuit Pope, is emphasizing throughout all the Catholic churches. Let's emphasize good works. Let's get rid of the miracles. Let's just, that's kind of like an embarrassing, you know, embarrassing episode in Christianity, the way they look at it. And now, the modernists, I say, no, we're modern, we're scientific now. No, you're not. Scientific means to examine all the evidence before you and draw appropriate conclusions and theories from the evidence. And to wipe out all the evidence of miracles is not scientific, but fanatically absurd. They're fanatic absurdists, is what they really are. So if the fanatic absurdists get too much leverage here, the grace of God is going to work to make sure that we are not submerged and we don't go down the drain. Sometimes you don't know what you got until it's gone, right? You don't realize, wow. But now I think it's time for us to wake up and say, hey, wait a minute, not so fast, modern culture, not so fast. I am not willing to give up that great tradition of miracles. One of the great things that, for me, that Ananda Mahima did was she confirmed for me and revalidated Jesus, because all the miracles that she did, I said, hey, you see, it is possible to do all those miracles here. Therefore, it's very likely that Jesus did them, isn't it? Validated Jesus very strongly. Supremely helpful in that regard. Keeping the great tradition alive, which then means that we keep faith in the great, you know, banner carriers of our traditions, that indeed they did do all those miracles. They did not value time. They did not value time or process or time, space, process, or form. They did not value absurdity. And they told us that we don't have to either. What part of denying truth is not absurd, and what part of waiting on absurdity? How much waiting is required to make absurdity not absurd? Or to make part of absurdity not absurd? How much waiting is required? This is the questions. These are the type of questions we need to hold in our mind. So, I am not willing to jettison the great tradition of miracles. I'm not willing to do that. I won't do it. And I think this is the attitude that we need to have for ascension. And to say, if you want me to entertain such an attitude, I'll do it in another life, not this life. I'm not willing to do it in this life. If you want me to go along with absurdity, if I need to consider that, I'll consider it in another life. But I'm not going to consider it or go along with it in this life at all. Not at all. And this is the adamant spirit we need to have. And we need to have it now, because again, just seeing how close we've come to letting this slip away from us is shocking. And to see it, say, wait a minute, the absurdists plan to have it slip away from us forever. buried and gone, and claiming that's mental illness to believe in it. And they're just about ready to slam the door shut on that and close the deal on that. And then we say, hey, wait a minute. Not so fast. So we may, you know, God's grace is going to act on this situation. Because the Holy Spirit is not into delay at all. Not at all. It's into ending delay. It's into ending absurdity. So any leverage and all leverage it needs to utilize, it will utilize. And we just need to make a commitment of which way are we going to go? Are we going to go the way of absurdity or the way of miracles, which is evidence of the falsity of absurdity and the falsity of valuing time? Time is just awaiting for some part of absurdity to be true. Or to not be absurd, just a waiting. It's just a waiting game. It's just a waiting game. Thinking, well, if I just wait, then some part of denying truth won't be absurd if I just wait long enough. If I just wait long enough, how long do we have to wait until some part of denying truth is not absurd? And just ask yourself, am I willing to play that waiting game? To go all in and invest, you know, all in on that waiting game. Am I willing to go all in on that waiting game? Or am I willing to say, you know what? I do believe in miracles. I'm going to go that direction. I'm going to commit to saying, yes, the evidence has been here, the evidence is profound, and I'm going to be scientific about this and follow the evidence instead of following the waiting game, playing the waiting game. So, good morning, Mr. Sunshine. You brighten up my day. The light of truth brightens our day here. And it's dawning upon me now. Oh, so this is what they're up to. That's very diabolical, isn't it? And they're trying to make this deal. They say, hey, I'll tell you what, let's focus on good works. And all you got to do is just give up your foolish belief in miracles. And we don't really have to believe that anymore because we've got, you know, the internet now. And we can all focus on good works. And that's what you really want. Let's make that deal. That's the deal that's being offered us. Let's say no deal. No deal. No deal to the devil, so to speak. The devil of waiting for some part of denial of truth to be anything other than absurdity. That's a false, vain hope. Okay. What type of pleasing absurdity makes the denial of truth any less absurd? How can we please absurdity to make the denial of truth any less absurd? Say, I'm very pretty. That's pleasing to absurdity. I'm very nice. That's pleasing. I'm very pleasing to absurdity. Okay. How can we be pleasing? How much pleasing of absurdity do we need to do to so that some denial of truth is less absurd in some part? Some part of denying truth is less absurd. How pleasing do we need to be? Now, there's a part of our mind it's like gasping for air now, saying, you're not supposed to ask these questions. I thought you'd never ask these questions. I didn't expect them. Gasping for air. But it's good. Like, wow. I didn't expect you'd ever get to this. So, just after this first part of this taping, I had a wonderful witnessing and got goosebumps. He was like, wow, that's what I need to hear. He said, basically, the gist of it was that, you know, we're on God's team. God is the coach, and we're on God's team, and God will take care of us. And then the one who was witnessing to me said, oh, I'm leaving for a vacation. Real nice vacation. I was like, wow, really? Yeah. All the family's getting together. Wow, interesting, right? All the family getting together from all over. Beautiful, beautiful resort vacation. Yeah. I was like, wow, okay. He's leaving tomorrow. Today's his last day. And I said, you're going to go walk on water. And he says, yeah. You got to get out of the boat in order to walk on the water. And the boat, of course, is this culture. This world, which is belief that, you know, some part of waiting and pleasing absurdity, so in some way, waiting and trying to please absurdity will make some denial, some part of denying reality will make it not absurd. That's the boat we've been in. You want to walk underwater, you got to get out of the boat. And he was talking about, you know, very, very, very good witnessing and a lot of areas. And the gist of it for me was that everyone has some focus here. And I was thinking, what is my focus? And I realized it's really examining miracles. I've spent a lifetime steeped in reading and studying the accounts of miracles historically, just because I felt that was very important. And so I am, you know, from the standpoint of evidentiary standpoint, I am absolutely valuable in that way. I'm a treasure house of awareness of the historical record, not from a standpoint of having some sort of photographic memory of it or notes about it or something, but I've taken it all in. And from this standpoint, then it alerts me to the attempt to submerge the scientific record. Submerge the evidence to come up with a preordained conclusion of absurdity. And I recognize the danger of this to our sanity. And I recognize the importance of those who have done the evidentiary work, who are scientists of miracles, of truth. The importance to preserve that record. And I'm getting some feeling of the value that I have, which I didn't have before. And so it's kind of like we reject miracles and say, well, I'm not that valuable. That's a trick. Right? We start thinking, wait a minute, so it must be a trick. I can't be that valuable. in seeing, now I'm starting to see the value that I have of the efforts that I've made. I was just a all-out researcher. I just researched and researched and researched voraciously. Say, what's the real evidence here? Who's right? Who's right? And I'm thankful for all the others who have researched this and helped out with their books and the historical record. And this is very valuable, actually. So it wouldn't be odd at all if I were to be helped out in some miraculous way to preserve that value. God is not absurd or capricious at saying that massive work towards valuing truth should just be flushed down the, you know, down the drain. Holy Spirit's not capricious or absurd. So here this witnessing what came to me just after doing this, the first part of this taping here, and it's this someone who feels he's being called to testify to God, and he's got this fabulous vacation, everything's working out so he can do that. And I'm saying, wow, I've also put in a ton of work, a massive amount of work. And I will not be submerged. I'm committed to that. So I'm thinking, hey, I'm on God's team, and God takes care of his team. That's the gist of the witnessing I got. God will take care of his team at the right moment, for sure. Took very interesting events this is relevant with the golf club. The driver had that seemed to break. Something was inside, it's rattling. I was asked to deliver something yesterday that someone couldn't do it, and I said, okay, I'll do it. And it turns out it was right near a golf store, and I said, let me bring the club in and maybe just ask them a question. And I brought it in and I explained, and they said, oh yeah, that's just a rattle. Some glue probably came loose. We can fix it, no problem. I said, what? Really? Yeah. Do it all the time. He said, oh my gosh. So it's not irretrievably broken. I said, yeah, it'll be ready in a little while. So this is a metaphor for the world. The world is not irretrievably broken. It's just going through a very severe illness right now. Trouble. Something's come a crop, or something's come loose. And I was so enthused, I missed the turnoff. That's okay. Again, I just, oh, okay. Just make a U-turn. Yeah, it's about a couple minutes. And get to be aware of where I'm at right now. Some beautiful gold fields right here. Wildflowers, really. Looks like the wildflowers around California might really be extraordinary this year, actually. I maybe want to check into that. I used to go around and chase the wildflowers, take pictures of them, and that was a lot of fun. You get to go in the backcountry of California and just see the beauty of it, and yeah, boy, when the wildflowers are out, oh my, it's really something. Who knows? Might even be a good year for the poppies. Possible. That's got, well, I'm going to check that. Got me fired up. I mean, it's been really terrible for a long time. I think the last time it was good was, what was it, 2001 or something? 2001 or 2002? I was there. That was a mind blower. Absolute mind blower. It's sort of like a precursor to miracles, really. Precursor. It sort of jolts the mind. It really jolted my mind. Something you never expected, never even thought about or considered or imagined, and you're driving into it, and you just, I have a video of that I made, and I was just screaming. I mean, it was so beautiful. Everybody was. It was so beautiful. The air was just full of this honeyed scent. Everywhere you look, massive billions of poppies, really. And just, people were just like, I can't believe this. I mean, this is, what do I, is this heaven? I mean, what? You know, one moment you're driving along a barren freeway in the desert, and then you start saying, what, my God, look at the side of the road. Poppies, and then more, and more, and more, and more, and more. It's like a super abundance. It was like an experience of super abundance, completely unexpected. Where did it come from, right? Where did this come from? And hasn't been back since because of the weather conditions haven't been right. I got a feeling, though, and going to Death Valley when there was a big rain there and wildflowers all over Death Valley and a lake in Death Valley. I got pictures of we were there when there was this lake in Death Valley with people kayaking on the lake. That was amazing. Beautiful wildflowers everywhere. And I, you know, so another, again, in the barren desert, in this most hostile place, you know, in the world almost, Death Valley, really. To see wildflowers everywhere and the beauty, I just floored me. And we need more of this. This is what I crave. You know, we need more witnessing. So California's done a great job of helping us. And again, I'm asking for the cherry on top here. Cherry on top. The acacia are all blooming right now. So I've got all these trees bursting with yellow blossoms, and now hillside full of mustard greens, bright yellow mustard greens in contrast with this deep emerald green. Cruising past the eucalyptus here, and it's a beautiful sight to see. This is the spring-like day today. Anyway, so the golf club's getting fixed in about 5 days or so. I said, so we get a 5-day break. 5-day meaning what? 5 month, 5 year, 5 decade? I don't know. Or a break in the fifth dimension, right? We get a break in the fifth dimension, which is called a reduced intensity zone. Just think of acronym Arizona. Acronym, where are you going? Acronym Arizona. A reduced, where are you going for vacation? I'm going to Arizona. Oh, really? Yeah, a reduced intensity zone. A-R-I-A, reduced intensity Z-O-N-A, zone, zona, a reduced intensity zona. Which is an absurdist paradigm. Claims that all the miracles were just anomalies, scientific anomalies, that misrepresentations, mass hallucinations, hypnotism, you know, misinterpretation, misunderstanding, all can be explained by science, or by empirical, Aristotelian, Lockean science. All can be explained by time, space, process, and form, in other words. This is their absurdist position. Completely absurdist. In as to the question, relevant question. See, for instance, like let's take UFOs, for instance. The relevant question is, are there UFOs? That's the relevant question. It's not how many sightings were accurate and how many were not. That's not the relevant scientific question to be answered. The question is, do they exist at all? Yes or no? It's very black and white. So it doesn't matter that there may have been some credulous people, and no doubt there have been, right? That's not the relevant question that we're looking to solve, to answer scientifically. Let's say 10 people were credulous and 10 were accurate. Very accurate. Very good witnesses. Very accurate. It's a lock that what they saw accurately. Are we then to say, well, no, you can't really trust the evidence? Really? Is that being scientific? Saying you can't trust the evidence because there were a few liars, for instance, and then the others telling the truth, and we have to then say those who are telling the truth are not relevant because there were some liars? That sounds like the logic of absurdity. And indeed, it is. The illogic, the insanity of absurdity. So they want to say, well, we've got to quantify, so you don't have 100% accuracy, we're just crunching the numbers. They keep crunching the numbers, avoiding the questions, you know, does something exist? Like, for instance, for example, do UFOs exist? Are there advanced flying devices beyond what we're expecting? And if you look at all the evidence, or, you know, a great preponderance of it, and you don't even have to do that. If you find a lot of credible evidence, very strong evidence, you don't need to wade through all the false reports or the lying or all that. You don't need to wade through all of it, right? Certainly not. What you're looking for is credible evidence. If you have very strong, credible evidence, then you're justified in saying, okay, we have a hypothesis here. And then you're justified in looking, testing that hypothesis out. You don't have to, at that point, wade through all the lies. It's not necessary. Absurdity claims, no, you got to count all the grains of sand on the beach. Let's say you're on a beach and you find some gold nuggets in with the sand. You say, oh, this beach has got gold. I see some gold. And you find more and more gold nuggets, and you conclude, you know what, there are gold nuggets on this beach. This beach is worth mining, for instance. Absurdity would say, well, yeah, but some of the beach is sand. And so you need to find out how much of the beach is sand, measure every, count every piece of sand. It says, I want a count of every piece of sand. But you would say, no, the point is, I found value here, significant value. I'm aware of very strong value here. That's the question we have, that there's strong value here. We don't need to say how much value. I mean, we make an assessment. Well, I'm finding massive amounts of gold. That's plenty worth, you know, picking up the gold, right? But absurdity would say, no, you can't reach that conclusion yet. Yet. In other words, we're waiting for the conclusion. Of course, absurdity is always waiting for some aspect of denying reality to not be absurd. So it just plays a waiting game. That's all absurdity is trying to do, is a waiting game. And trying to get us to think that that's sanity. So absurdity would say, you need to count every grain of sand on the beach and tally all up. We need a count of that before we can possibly even get around to assessing the value. I say, well, that will take almost forever. I mean, the beach, you know, massive 3-mile beach, so wide. I mean, there's trillion to the trillionth, you know, number as far as grains of sand on the beach. That'd take for almost forever to count all those. And there, so he says, well, you got to do it. And he said, no, wait a minute. That's absurd. Or let's say you come up in the desert, you come across a oasis, you're very thirsty, you come across an oasis, and there's this beautiful lake and flowing water, and you say, oh, that's great. And absurdity will say, wait a minute, we don't know how much lack of water there is in the desert. So you got to determine that first before you can drink anything. So we want you to wander about in the desert and find out all the areas that don't have water first. Let's find all the areas that don't have value. You say, wait a minute, isn't that enough? If your goal is to find value, that when you find it, that's good enough? Do you really have to also find non-value? Why? See, it's absurd. It's like finding totality. And the ego will say, voice of absurdity will say, okay, you found totality, but now you've got to find non-totality also. You know, to make sure you be able to define where that is. So wait a minute. My goal, no, wait a minute. No, I don't need to wait on that. Let's not wait a minute. I don't need to define the absence of totality. There is no absence of totality. So when you find the water, you don't need to define the absence of the water. You need to drink. And, of course, analogies and such as this and metaphors, they're not, you can always attack them. Okay, of course, because we're using words. But when we're talking about, we're pointing to totality, to pure spaciousness. And there is no absence of pure spaciousness. There are no exceptions to it. So why do we need to define an exception to it? Why do we need to search for exceptions to it? That's absurdity. Why do we need to wait before realizing this, before seeing it? Well, to please absurdity. And we think by pleasing absurdity, that'll make some part of denying truth less absurd. This lady has a big sun hat with flaps. It reminds me of The Flying Nun. The Flying Nun, there's a TV show, The Flying Nun or something. They're trying to secularize it, even at that point, weren't they? The secularity has just tried to steamroll. Keel haul, you know, the great tradition of help and grace in this world. Trivializing it. And they've been working at it relentlessly. That's absurdity. And they think those who are doing that say, well, I'm pleasing absurdity. Yeah, but how much pleasing of absurdity is necessary for some part of denial to be less absurd? How much? This is the question to ask. We don't need to attack, you know, the idea of, well, you know, you shouldn't be trying to please absurdity. Well, if you think it's pleasing to absurdity, I'm sure absurdity is pleasing. Yeah, great. You know, the ego's saying, oh, okay, you're really doing great for me. Yeah, the ego's saying that. But that doesn't, we say, well, it doesn't get us anywhere, because the ego says, but you don't get any payoff until some aspect of denying truth is less absurd. That's your payoff. You don't get that until that's true. And it's never true. So you never get the payoff. So there's no doubt the ego's cheerleading and saying, wonderful, you're doing a great job, doing a great job, as you try to wait and be pleasing to absurdity and try to crush the great tradition of truth here. There's no doubt the ego is cheering that on. Pleasing to the ego, but what does that get us? And what is that ever going to get us? Ha! has a bumper sticker right in front of me, the car I'm following. It says, I'd rather be here now. Wow, I'd rather be here now. Oh, never seen that bumper sticker before. Of course, that comes from Be Here Now. The book by Ram Dass, Be Here Now. Richard Alpert, nee, Ram Dass. Be Here Now, which was a, you know, help people, help revitalize our interest in miracles because they were crushing Christianity and secularity. And then we said, wow, this isn't good. And so branched out ecumenically to more of the great traditions of the world, and we found it there too. We said, hey, wait a minute. They also have miracles. In fact, that's a universal. It's been all over. So, not so fast here. Stop trying to... Why crush Christianity? Make an example. That's stupid. We should cherish all of the traditions, and all the evidence should be cherished, including Christianity. Absolutely. So, I don't know what everyone's done with that ecumenicalism. It certainly helped me. Of course, it could be misused, saying, hey, wait a minute. You know, all this talk about how great Christianity is, that's not true. It could be used that way too, right? I understand. It's a double-edged sword. So it's up to how people use the information. But like I have said here, that nothing eclipses what Jesus did. Nothing eclipses it. It's very important to hear that. Because I'm very aware of the traditions, the greatness of other traditions. But there's nothing in any of those traditions that eclipses what Jesus did. That's a fact. So what it can do is it helps revitalize the cherishment that we have, those who have more familiarity with Christianity. It helps revitalize that and cherish it. And what incenses me is like the way Christmas has been used, which this is a time to focus in on how much we cherish this awesome tradition we have, this awesome body of evidence, the body of Christ, the body of evidence. That truth is true, and no part of absurdity is true. And this is essential for our sanity. So Christmas is a time to cherish our sanity. And instead, it's happy holidays. Buy more. And you have these powerful politicians whose goal it is to get Christ out of Christmas. You know, it doesn't get much worse than this, does it? I mean, this trend is an awful trend. It's a trend towards insanity, to idolizing insanity. It's a trend towards going into the darkness of superstition. They're going into a dark hole. This is what a dream showed me when I was shown the future. And I saw that we're being led into this dark, dark tunnel, this black, inky black tunnel. I said, wow, I'm not going there. And I looked up, I said, do we have any options? I looked up on the side of the mountain there, and there were beings up on the side, up higher above. They said, come up here, up above it. I said, yeah, I'm going to take that option. Take everything that is taking place in your life as the play of grace, as indeed it is. And then you'll get momentum out of it. For instance, we were in a restaurant yesterday, and this waitress came. And towards the end of our meal, we were chatting, she said, "Oh, I'm just new here. I just started. I've been here 3 days." And we said, "What? Really? Come on." And I asked her, "What did you do before?" I was a counselor here. I said, "Well, what kind of waitressing experience have you had?" She said, "None. This is the first time I've ever been a waitress, and only for 3 days." I said, and we were absolutely astonished, because we thought that, like, she was some expert. I mean, the way she handled things, it was like someone who's very skilled and expert. And we totally said, "That's astonishing." She goes, "Oh, thank you. No, I'm just really, just completely new at this." And wow. I said, "Well, you're a natural. You are absolutely just a natural at this. Amazing. Just the whole approach. Hi, folks, just the attitude. I mean, this is somebody who is just a great natural." And I said, "I wonder what this is about. Natural mind is just talented at everything. We're not waiting to please absurdity. We're not. So we can just be very, very, we're just naturally skilled in all directions. Or somebody that we don't know for very long at all can appear to serve us extremely well. Right off the bat, I mean, the service was really well done. She made a few mistakes, but those were just routines that she wasn't quite, you know, not quite used to. But as far as the overall manner in which we were served, it was like fabulous. I thought she was some, like, really, really expert waitress. We all did. And we had someone there who's an expert on restaurants and waitresses. And they said, "Wow, yeah, this person's a natural." So, do we have to have a natural prove themselves to us? Or is that an absurdity? As far as, "Well, you're 3 days, oh, really? Oh, well, you're no good. Therefore, you're no good." Is that evidence? Or is that absurdity? If someone's really good, are they not really good right now? If they're functioning in a great way right now, are they not functioning in a great way right now? But absurdity would say no. Gotta wait. Gotta please absurdity. Waiting pleases absurdity. Waiting aimlessly pleases absurdity. Trying to please absurdity pleases absurdity. But where's the payoff for pleasing absurdity? Where's the payoff? We say, "Well, we're still miserable." Absurdity says, yeah, I know, but very soon you won't be. Because the waiting will pay off. We won't be absurd anymore. Absurdity won't be absurd anymore. We say, "Oh, really?" At least I said, "No, wait a minute. Wait." I said, "Well, wait, just not so fast. Not so fast. It seems a little too slick." So, again, in the golf experience I had where I slipped at this little pond I was going towards, I was looking to see that maybe my ball went in there, or maybe there's some balls in there, and I don't need to be searching for that. I'm not going to use the balls anyway. I've committed to one brand. I want to stick with that. So why was I... It was just a whimsical, absurd thing to do. Why was I... I went down to the edge of this pond. Let me just look. It was a mistake. Greedy, capricious. I have to look at that more carefully. Anyway, it was so slick by the surface of by the edge of this pond. I have never experienced anything like it. Very unexpected. I mean, I have golf cleats on. I'm not going to slip. The idea of me slipping was ridiculous. And yet, both of my feet just come wet out from underneath me in an instant. And I was on my backside in thick, gooey, slimy mud. It's like, okay, I think I just ruined these pants. Okay. So what does that mean? There's something about this world and the slickness of the presentation to move us, you know, down the drain of absurdity. It's a very slick presentation right now. Very slick. And it may be too slick for us. Even though I said, well, I got cleats, I got golf cleats, I got really good ones. So I said, I'm not going to slip. And so I might be saying right now, I got really good understanding of miracles and absurdity and truth, and I have great understanding of all this. So I can't slip. A premonition of this. I said, don't go down there. I said, okay, I'm going to go down there. I want to see, there's a lesson to be learned. So it was sort of like that. So, okay, I'm going to learn a lesson. Well, a lesson was presented to me. The world, no matter what our clarity, what our grip is on truth, the slickness of this presentation through the use of advanced technologies, the slickness of it, is going to cause us to slip and fall if we don't back away from it. If we don't back away from it and say, I will look for my ball next round. Next time I'm here, I'll look for the ball. I don't really need it now. I have a bag full of balls, golf balls. Why did I need to go down there? Well, even if I don't know why, I can say, I don't really need it at all, and I'll get it next time. If I meant to find that golf ball, I will find it next round of golf, not this one. So if I'm meant to find something in a world, then I'll find it next time I find myself in the world, like in electromagnetism. If I'm meant to find something in electromagnetism, I'll find it next time I make an excursion into electromagnetism, but not this time. Maybe I was trying to rescue some golf balls from that pond. That's probably, you know, I said, well, maybe there's some balls over there. Let me pull them out. I don't really need them, but I'll try to help rescue them. Whoops, too slippery. And again, this goes back to now I'm seeing catastrophe as a trap. That those golf balls in that pond were a trap to lure me into slipping and falling. So those in this world who will not escape, sidestep the catastrophes and troubles, they're here to try to lure the rest of us into that catastrophic situation. They're crying, help, help, help us, help us, help, help, free us, liberate us, oh my God. And then you slip and fall, see? That's a trap. It's intentionally set up that way. Now, this is difficult for us to accept. We said, wow, it's really even, it's that treacherous. Wow. Yes, it is. Well, it means I've got to up my game. You know, in helping out, we have to up our game and really be, you know, more aware. So it means we have more work to do in terms of upping our game. Absolutely, it does. But I'm ready for it. That's what I've got to do. I have to do that. And I believe it is doable. It will be done. It's already done. But the teaching that I have received is, I can see it will get the job done. I recognize that. So this is quite a wonderful new belief system, new paradigm to look at it this way. Because we're worried, like, oh, is it really that treacherous? Well, I'll never be able to help them then. I mean, that's just too much. It's just too much. No, we could see it in context of absurdity. And absurdity's belief that it's just, we just wait long enough, that'll satisfy us. And then the work on very clever traps of delay, very clever traps of delay, that's what absurdity does. So it's not some anomaly that really stumps us. Not at all. We might say, wow, if absurdity is that tricky, you know, how out must be could be tricky in many other ways too. Well, sure. That's what it does. But we could certainly trump that through seeing. And we will be able to see. This is my conviction. The teachers that I'm aware of are more than capable, in fact, expertly capable, flawlessly capable of leading us to seeing. And when we're seeing that, of course, totality is, there's no absence of totality. There's no obstruction to totality. There's no obstruction to pure space. Just when we're seeing that, then we're not vulnerable to the treachery of absurdity. We're not vulnerable to it. I just had an interesting instance here. I needed to get over into an exit lane off the freeway. And so I slowed down. There's a car that was part of parallel in the exit lane. And there was another one behind me. And there was a little space there. So I got to get in. So I let it be known, signaled, I need to get in. And the car behind a little bit didn't want to let me in. You know, it's a typical thing here. Okay. So I said, boy, but I got to get in. So I said, okay, I'm just going to squeeze in. There was enough room, but, you know, it was a little bit tight. They might have to slow down a little bit. So I just started, you know, merging. I said, I'm going in. And they had to back off a little bit. They had to back off a little bit. And it's helpful that I have a large vehicle. They don't, you know, and that was a small car. They don't want to mess with it. It's like, so they're trying to say, no, you can't come in, you can't come in, you can't come in. I said, I'm coming in. They said, oh my God, I got to slow down. Gotta let him in. So use your weight a little bit. It's like the guru, the weightiness. The guru, you know, throws their weight around. You got to. People here don't want to let the guru in. No, you can't be here. I'm coming in. Oh, I got to back off our absurdity a little bit here then. So today, again, our mission is what? To establish a new normal. And so we're working all out on that so far. So far. Driving by all the tech places now, and the techies are out there, and, you know, they're working hard to please absurdity, making a slicker and slicker and slicker presentation, so that we think, hey, maybe there really is a superficial way to help everyone, and just we just wait, and we're happy waiting, because we got all this slickness now, but we don't realize how slick it is. What the purpose of it is. And a lot of people have been fooled by this. I had intuition. If I listened to my intuition, we all have intuition. I just listened to it and said, better hedge my bets here on this one. I got this feeling, technology, there could be a very dark side to it. And it could be a setup. It could be really being just set up. This could be absurdity, just setting us up for a big fall. A big fall. That's what I had playing golf that day. I had a big fall. Fortunately, I'm in good shape, so it didn't bother me. Bounced right back up. No harm. But it was symbolizing, you know, hey, big fall. We're getting set up here for a big fall. Now, this is what my intuition has been telling me. Don't trust it. Now, when in Rome, do as Romans do, so we use a little technology here so as not to alarm the citizens who are going along with this. But we hedge our bets. We hedge our bets. We're also willing to ascend. We're also willing to sidestep. If we are being set up, we're willing to sidestep that setup. If we are being set up, we are ready, willing, and able to sidestep that setup. That's called hedging our bets, and we're well within our rights to do so. We have something, the way that it has unfolded, technology, this whole situation, the way that it has unfolded, we are well within our rights to say, to hedge our bets. Well within our rights. The evidence absolutely supports that. And absurdity, you say, well, you're not being scientific, you're being irrational. No, just the opposite. To not hedge your bets is being supremely irrational in this situation. Terribly irrational. I believe what that incident of slipping by the pool was saying, trying to make further efforts of involvement with this world at this time, it's too slippery. The slope has gotten too slick. But at some other point, it won't be as slick when things dry out a little bit. Then be able to help out, but right now it's too slick. So that's probably what it was telling me. I say, well, it's okay. I got these cleats. No, it's too slippery even for that. Even with all the understanding I have, it's still too slippery. Okay. All right. I have to accept that. I was so caught by surprise there. Even after all the experience I've had in this world, that one caught me by surprise. I have never encountered anything so slick in my life. It's more slick than ice. was like riding on like mud on ball bearings. You step on the ball bearings, it just whoosh, goes. So that was a real setup. And this world is like that. That's the analogy I was being shown this. It's that slippery of a slope right now. It's that slick of a situation. And the ones that are seemingly in trouble here, it's a setup. They're part of the whole thing, saying, oh, help, help us, help, help. You know, it's the damsel in distress sort of thing. Be very careful of the damsel in distress. This is something that throughout history has been very well known. Oh, help, help, I've been in so much trouble. Oh my gosh, it's awful, oh my gosh. And you try to help out. Take me back to safety. Where's safety? Well, there's some place around here. Oh, here's a place, you know. And okay, you go in there and you relax your guard, and next thing you know, robbers assail you. She's working for the robbers. This is something throughout the testimony of history here we're well aware of, that a damsel in distress may not be what superficially it appears to be. And the damsel is more than willing to work with robbers, whatever, to survive and get something for her children, for instance. So this is a very dangerous situation, damsel in distress. And this world might be seen as a damsel in distress right now. So indeed it is appearing to be that way. And the Holy Spirit says, don't be deceived. Appearances are very deceptive. So I'll go with the Holy Spirit on this one. And what do I have to lose out? Well, you know, maybe I won't be some superhero. We're able to say, oh, you saved us. You're such a hero. For all time, you'll be remembered as a hero. Well, you know, I don't need that. I don't need that. That's all we have to lose. I mean, the carrot is, you could be such a massive hero here. That's the carrot. That's the temptation. Whoa, big slowdown here suddenly on the freeway. I wonder why. Wow, completely stopped. I don't know. And a car just zoomed around me dangerously. People, I just slowed down. I said, okay, it'll clear up here. Just a minute. No, a car had to try and be a hero. It says, I gotta be a speeded up hero here. So I get around now safely. So I did it safely. I just wait a little bit there. It's called good driving. In other words, the car behind me did a very dangerous maneuver. They say, well, maybe I can be a hero. And now I see what's going on. The road is blocked. The ramp exiting the freeway is completely blocked. Wow, there must have been some big accident or something. So all these trucks up there. So this is why it's all backed up. It's blocked. Similar to the world, right? Maybe something, some big accident coming in the world. Maybe some very big accident coming in this world. Couple of them. Acts of absurdity. Acts absurdities coming. Acts absurdities. There'll be some absurdities coming. So, again, our experiencing here mirrors our consciousness, and it's amazing how that I'm aware of this now. More aware. Don't need to try and be a hero right now. There's plenty of room for being a spiritual hero down the road if that's what we really crave. The Holy Spirit's the real hero anyway, so if we don't get that, then we get in trouble. We're just on the Holy Spirit's team. It's not for us to be the heroes of salvation. The Holy Spirit's the hero of salvation. God created to be the hero of salvation. God did not create us to be the heroes of our own salvation. So that's not our role. Our role is to be a good team player. And do what the Holy Spirit suggests that we do, advises us that we do. Don't go rogue on the Holy Spirit and say, wait a minute, I think I see a great opportunity. What is it? It's 12:40 and it's the traffic is really heavy now. Can't escape it here, huh? Heavy traffic. We can sidestep it though. Bumper sticker, I'd rather be here now. Yeah, that's great. I'd rather be here now. You get these bumper stickers. I'd rather be driving a Titleist. I'd rather be doing this. I'd rather be here now. I'm looking for the exit I need. I'm not seeing it yet. I'd rather be here now. Rather be here now. How about that? That's a great, great motto to have. I'd rather be here now. Maybe I'm gonna have a bumper sticker made up like that for our vehicle to say, I'd rather be here now. That's great. That's talks our talk. Those who have ears to hear this talk, that's a very strong statement. I'd rather be here now. Be here now means in totality. Being now is seeing totality. Being here now is seeing totality. I'd rather be here now. Instead of waiting to be here, I'd rather be here now. Instead of waiting to try to please absurdity, I'd rather be here now. Wow, low tide right now. Going past some tidal area, and really low tide. There's the exit. That's coming up in a little while here. See. Just getting more familiar with the peninsula area here. Not really that familiar with it, actually. Wow, look at the tidal flats. It's down to the mud there. I'd rather be here now. This is an affirmation, okay? We're in the affirmation part of our practice. I'd rather be here now. Wow. Very powerful. I'd rather be here now. Very nice. I'd rather be here now. Wow. Passing this hotel, that reminds me where I'd rather be. Hyatt Regency. I'd rather be here now. With near the airport. We're near the airport. Again, I had to get over. They don't like to let you get over here, I'm telling you. If I see someone trying to get over, okay. Just ease off the gas, you know. Just coast a little bit, let them get in. But here they're like, let me make them uncomfortable. It's just a matter of comfort. Do you give them some comfort, or do you make them feel uncomfortable with getting in? And just a little bit of easement. Reduced intensity zone, right? A reduced intensity zone. A little bit of easement. Make us feel comfortable with miracles, right? With not valuing time. And you can tell when you make a signal, try to get over, it's like, are they going to make me comfortable or uncomfortable? And you get a lot of uncomfortableness here now. You don't want that feeling. It's a subtle thing, but you can tell what kind of land you're in from that subtle little thing. You can just tell where their mentality is at. But if you're going to be exiting from the freeway, they're in the exit lane. I mean, why do you need to make someone uncomfortable? It's not really going to slow you down. I mean, the car that got in front of is right behind me. You know, it's because you're slowing down anyway to exit. So it's just stupid not at that kind of situation not to let someone in if you know they can obviously. Now the car isn't actually in front of me, so they didn't get displaced in any way actually. I'm just gonna bet that this is the street. I don't know this area. It is. Ah, good. Great. Look at this fanciness here. I'd rather be here now. I'd rather be here now. What a great statement. See, it's a preference, right? So we're allowing ourselves, accommodating the continuity fear. I'd rather be here now. And if I'm not here now, that'll be in the future sometime. Yeah. Another life. Rather be here now. Okay. And now another turn. Uncharted territory, but I'm getting there. I'd rather be here now. Use it. There's another thing I got today that someone was giving, some witnessing. I said, look, I use your stuff. I pass it on. He said, that's what you're supposed to. That's great. That's what we all need to do. If someone gives us some witnessing to that's helpful for us, pass it on. He said, this is what happened to me. God really came through for me. Pass that information on. Let's see if I can get a parking space here. Pass the good witnessing on. Well, I'm in gridlock here, actually. Officially. I take the turn signal off because it's not, it doesn't matter. We are stuck here. Just trying to make a simple turn. Finally some easement here, but this is a bad spot for making a turn. Now, just had a very interesting situation occur, and it's worth mentioning. The Holy Spirit, again, everything's grace. We're just being pointing out to the Holy Spirit. I just let somebody in there. See, that's what you do. I don't want them to be stuck either. Oh, I see the lane is blocked here. Yeah, bad situation. Okay, so here's a bad situation, and I just had another bad situation before this. And that is, I'm at the store, and they give me a pickup ticket, claim ticket, and then go into the warehouse and wait for someone who works there to take your ticket and fill your order. So I said, okay, great. So I'm waiting there. There's nobody there. I said, wow. Okay, so I'm wait. And then I see an employee coming, and he's helping someone else, and he sees me. I say, okay, when he's done, he'll help me. So here comes, and then later on, here comes this other customer, wanders in, but he has a pick ticket. He says, okay. And this employee is coming back from their, what they're doing, and he tries to give his ticket to the guy. Well, he looks at me, he sees me. He sees I have a pick ticket too. But he's, obviously he knows, he can tell, I've been waiting there. So he thinks maybe I could jump in front of this guy. And he said, it's worth a try. But the employee was still working, so didn't work. And then I wondered, what's gonna happen here? And ultimately, when the employee was done, they knew that I was first. I was there first for sure. And they came over to help me. And the other guy was kind of like, ah, didn't work. You know, tried to jump the line, didn't work. And this is so unusual because here in America, you don't do that. You wait your turn. Pretty much the country's based on that is fair play, wait your turn, right? And what was unusual, what caught my eye about the whole thing was, is this isn't the first time that this has happened to me recently, and it just happened to be. Is it coincidence, or is it pointing something out to me? And the man who tried to do that was a Chinese. And so have the other incidents been with Chinese. Same thing. And you look at the way they drive, and the accidents I've almost had have been with Chinese trying to push their way in where there's no room. They say, well, get out of my way. I say, wow, this is a very different cultural situation. You just don't do that. Americans, if they tried to do that, you know, if he was American, I'd say, hey, buddy, what are you trying to do? You got to wait your turn. And they would be shamed. Like, it's a shameful thing to do to be a line jumper here. Very shameful. They'd say, sorry, I shouldn't have done that. But this guy, he didn't have any contrition or anything. He's just like, ah, how come I wasn't able to do that? And I just say, wow, the Holy Spirit's pointing something out. Wow, there's this attitude out there that says, if we can jump in front of you, we're going to do it. We're not going to wait our turn. We are going to, if we see an opportunity, we're going to try and grab it. So, just pointing out cultural differences here and the problem that could bring about in the world. Maybe part of a constellation of troubles here. The Chinese have a history of that, don't they? In various ways. Look at Tibet, for instance. And testimony from other people around the world, their countries, you know, they come in and they try to jump ahead right now. Well, they may not be the only ones, but this is just a pragmatic situation that the Holy Spirit brought to my attention. And again, the way they drive, I'm not the only one. Everyone I talk to says, what's up with these Chinese drivers here? The way they drive is like, we say, it's crazy. You know, you don't do that here. Well, it's a cultural difference for sure. So you have a clash of cultures. You have a potential clash of cultures heating up big time. Big time. Very dangerous situation. When we talk about trying to get a global culture, well, you know, that's not going to happen until, you know, the reason why we had sort of the world seemed to smooth out a little bit when the United States was like a global superpower unopposed. We thought, oh, finally, maybe we can get a global culture here out of this. But not so fast. The Chinese said, whoa, wait a minute. The Russians, wait a minute. They said, yeah, let's have a global culture. Let it be our culture. And the Chinese feel entitled to that, being that their culture is so ancient. Indians do too. I mean, there are people, various people feel entitled that their culture should be the global culture. They should be the global leaders. Now, the Hispanics, they understand that, actually. I mean, I've always felt that treated, that they get it. Now, you might say, well, they didn't wait in line to come into the country. True enough. But I don't see them... I see that they get it. As far as the culture is close enough, that they understand. Okay, he's here first, and you know, I got to wait my turn. I've always felt that they're very much attuned to that. So that doesn't really concern me. I feel that the Hispanics would make very good citizens here. The ones that, you know, keep their noses clean, make very good citizens, actually. Work hard, fair play, advancement, it takes time, etc., etc. So, but Chinese, different story. Really, and the times like I caught them, they go, like, but you know, I know that they, next time they try to do it again. I said, well, I didn't get away with it this time, maybe next time. Not a good situation. We don't like that here. You know, our culture doesn't work if we allow that sort of thing. Then you'd be at each other's throats, you know. It's just... Anyway. Interesting vignette there. And again, the Holy Spirit's just saying, hey, just pointing it out to you. You think everything's going to be fine here. Not so fast, not so fast. Yeah, the Chinese are saying to the United States, hey, not so fast, not so fast. You think you're going to dominate the world? Whoa, 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 wait a minute. We have our ideas of what we want, not so fast. So, it's not a good situation, to say the least. And that fits in with what we've been talking about. That we may need to sidestep things. Things may be getting real slick here. Real slick. And whoops, before you know it, there goes our feet. We land in the muck and the mire. And what is that? I mean, landing in the muck and the mire is symbolic for a, you know, real situation that, you know, really ruins our clothing, so to speak. Our vehicles and our mindset, it's very, very bad for that. So, okay, warning has been, you know, noticed. I'm very aware of this. Just look at, if you know history, you know how things go. And you get warning signs. If you look historically in hindsight, you say, well, okay, this was a warning sign of what was to come, and this too, and this too, and this too, and there's a whole set of warning signs historically that precede real bad trouble. You get the polarizations, you get the entitlement complex on both sides, you get the pit bull mentality, you get the zero tolerance mentality. And you get the ego sensing opportunity. You get the yoga girls in there that feel now's their time to, you know, to seize unopposed power forever. You get a mix of this stuff, and you get enough mix of that stuff, and you're certainly scientifically justified to draw up a hypothesis and say, and also say, let us do some contingency planning. Again, do scientists do no contingency planning? I mean, they got a whole seed bank in Norway. I mean, probably multiple seed banks all over the world right now, hedging their bets, right? I mean, to be a scientist, don't you, if the evidence warrants it, don't you say, you know what? I think we better, you know, build a bunker, or build, you know, or have some land over here, or, you know, whatever. It's being intelligent, following the evidence. There's a lot of evidence right now. The world is headed for the mire, the muck and the mire. So let us hedge our bets and have a contingency ready. And accept that it may already be ready for us by those who have been more scientific than we have and have been aware of the evidence and acted accordingly as we kind of, you know, dawdled along and and said, well, I'm not sure, you know, as we sort of kept entertaining absurdity out of the bad habit of doing that. There are those who did not entertain absurdity and said, we know what's coming, so we're going to prepare and have contingency plans ready, not only for us, but for those who decide to make a commitment to truth, to dropping the value of time, decide to drop their valuing of absurdity, let us have it ready for them too. Because they are simpatico with us and they will help us out down the road greatly. Isn't this very reasonable? Those who have dropped absurdity, they realize that many have not, and they're very severely addicted to it. And so, and out of compassion, their job is to help the Holy Spirit. So, they're looking for those to help them out, make their job easier, make it happen quicker. So they are going to identify who can help them and certainly are going to help them out. So then later on they can, you know, add to the helpfulness of it all. It's a no-brainer. It's very obvious. If you have like a really tough job to do, and it's like the laborers are few, you know, like you and a couple others, it's like, wow, this is such a huge burden. Wouldn't you say, I wonder if anyone else can join us and help us out? Many hands make light work. And wouldn't you say, I'm gonna look around and see if I can find someone who's able to handle this tough work? Of course, any reason would do this. And when you find someone, let's say you find someone who's got the capacity, but they're a little lazy, and they need a little help, you know, and they're getting sort of pulled down by a couple factors. You might say, okay, let me see what I can do to free them up from these factors that are hindering them. Because if I free them up, I can see that the potential is very strongly there and they're going to be able to help me out. Many hands making lighter work. Very smart thing to do, very wise. So why should we not credit those who have obviously through their miracles demonstrated that they're beyond the valuing of time entirely, and therefore free of absurdity entirely? Why don't we credit them with some intelligence that they're looking out for those that they can see are going to be helpful to them? It would be absurd to not credit them with this. So we're saying that Jesus, definitely the evidence is there, that no one eclipses the evidence that he's presented. The evidence clearly indicates that he's totally beyond the valuing of time, which means he's totally beyond the valuing of absurdity, because the only way absurdity can remain in our belief is through time, belief in time, space, process, and form. Jesus clearly showed he had completely seen through this as an illusion, as a delusion, and no longer believed in it at all. So why can't we not credit then Jesus with the intelligence to help us out, to have already done what's required to help us out, to have done proper and wise contingency planning? To not credit Jesus with this would be an absurdity. It would be absurd for Jesus to say, well, I got free absurdity, but no one else can, so I have to do everything myself. And that's absurd. In getting free absurdity, he would have recognized that it's doable for all of us. And he would know that. And he would know we all have to be saved from it. And therefore, he would know that he has to do contingency planning to get some help. Just intelligence would say, I'd rather give help, more help the better. If you've got a project like this, you welcome all the help you can get. That is for sure. So he would definitely do contingency planning to help us out. To not do it would be an absurdity. And since he's beyond absurdity, that scientifically we would say, and reasonably, He must have done contingency planning. He could not have done it. That would be just a total absurd anomaly if he didn't do any of that. Totally. So it'd be an absurdity. And that contraindicates, his actions contraindicate that he functions absurdly. So therefore, he has done contingency planning. Not maybe. The evidence would say, reason would say he has done it to the best of his ability. And since he has no absurdity in him whatsoever, is not hindered by time, space, process, or form, the best of his ability would be flawless. It would be effective. It would have to be. So here we're letting reason lead the way instead of absurdity. And to believe that not this has not happened would is an absurdity. It would be rejecting Jesus, actually. It would be superstitious, blind faith in absurdity. So you see how this helps us with ascension, is our reason, we precondition ourselves to reasonably expect what we will come across. As I've always said, the Holy Spirit has a great sense of humor. It's just amazing. And I just had an incident here happen. Driving along, up to a stop sign, and there's this box, cardboard box, was on the road. It had fallen out of somebody's vehicle. And I say, huh, I wonder what's in there. Maybe something I could use, right? The thought crosses our mind, we see that. And I pass the box by, I'm looking at it, and it's full of children's toys. I say, I don't need that. I don't need that stuff. I'm not going to stop. I'm not going to stop for that. And I just drove right on past. This is an analogy for the world, isn't it? And these gadgets that we have in the world. I'm not going to stop for these gadgets. This right? Those are children's toys. The people are waiting in absurdity like children, foolish children, naive, foolish children. I'm not going to stop and rummage around in that stuff. Come on. Toys for little kids, little kiddies' toys. I'm not interested in that. That's a great analogy. We're here going through all these massive tech buildings here. It's a perfect analogy for the technological world here. That the Holy Spirit had some box of toys fall off the vehicle somewhere, like so I could have this experience, and maybe others too. It'll make use of that experience to say, somebody come along and say, aha, now I see. This world, these are foolish little childish toys we have here, is it not? Very childish. Yes, it is. Wow. Now, we talk about waiting in line. Well, as far as ascending, you don't have to wait in line. It's just a decision. You're not blocking anybody else time-wise by ascending at all. It's not like the same kind of waiting in line that we have, wait in line to get into a movie, or whenever we, in line for the cashier. You don't just cut in front of the line. You wait your turn. Funny. It's real weird. It's weird. It's like the Chinese have an entitlement complex. There's no question about it. And I think everyone knows that in the world, right? I'm not saying something that is odd to say at all. And because I've had situations where, like, I'm waiting in line at the cashier or something. It's completely obvious. And they just walk right in front and go up to the cashier. And the cashier says, he was here first. And they kind of look like, what? Like, so what? I mean, I have to wait in line? What? I thought these other people here, they're not entitled to go to the front of the line. I'm entitled to go to the front of the line here. I don't have to wait for these people. What do you mean? Like genuinely, like surprised, like they were like slaves. They don't view us as equal. The great thing about America is all the immigration here is that we're under enormous pressure to view everyone as equal here. And it doesn't matter what your background is in term, but you know, you're in line, you're in line. You don't jump in front of somebody. They're equal, waiting for a cashier, waiting for help. Everyone's equal. That's the ideal that is drilled into us here. And this is what everybody tries their best to, you know, to live up to. Equal in the eyes of the law, equal in this way, and this way, and this way, every which way, supposedly. Now, obviously, other cultures have a different idea that they're entitled, they feel that they're entitled to view themselves as superior and see how much they can get away with that. And that others are underlings to them. I don't know how else to look at it, and I think the evidence points out that there is this entitlement complex. And historically, that's been present. Man, that doesn't play well with our ethos here. Whatever faults people want to try to point out about it, the fact of the matter is, there's no place in the world where you have such diversity and people getting along and waiting, taking turns and trying to do fair play as best we can. This is very amazing. You go out and you encounter people of every, from all over the world, backgrounds. All right, now continue to get amazing grace-filled experiences, and I will run this by you here. Just an amazing experience just happened. I'm in a place picking something up, and there's this old vehicle there in the parking lot, and I asked the guy, I said, "Oh, is this yours?" He says, no, somebody else's. I said, "I wonder what year it is." We start chatting about the vehicle, and he is very knowledgeable about it. He said, "By the way, just on the corner here, there's a garage, a repair place that specializes in repairing these, and they're just packed. Everybody brings them here. They're great." I say, "Oh, really, really interesting." And then I thought, hey, I know somebody who has one of these vehicles, and they're needing to have it repaired all the time. I said, "You know what? I should get the name of this garage and give it to him, so next time he has a problem with his vehicle, you know, here's an option for him." So I said, "Okay, I'll do that." So I go there, and I give him a call. I say, "Hey, you know, what do you think?" And he says, "Really?" He says, "Oh my gosh, I'm just getting ready to take my vehicle into a place. I have major problems with it, and I really need a place to take it." Right at that moment that I called him. You cannot write this script for this stuff. And so I texted him all the information. That means he's got this great, you know, asset option there for these experts, which was, I say, was just actually just what he was looking for. He was just looking for, he needed it right this minute. And I happened to then get this information right at this moment, and then thought of him and gave it to him. So you have enough of those instances like this, you realize there's something going on more than we realized, and that we must therefore be dwelling in absurdity, really, to not see this, to not recognize it, to not be aware of the source of this, the source of this amazing synchronicity. And it has something to do with a willingness to help others, because I'm willing to help out. I have this willingness to help him, and so the situation that arose to help him out, you know, it's like, wow. Now, just take these gurus who have perfect desire to help everyone, and just, you can understand how the flow of their life must go, and that everything is synchronicitous. Here's somebody that was trapped in the exit, they didn't want to get in, they say, "Whoops, they need to get out, I saw it, what did I do? I hit the brake, let him in." Why? Make it easy, make it comfortable for them. Keep it comfortable. So, we are told that these teachers, like Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma, and look, examine her life, there's no question that it was a flow of amazing synchronicity, and people were with her, commented and wrote books on it, that You know, she'd go to a train station with no money. She didn't have any money or, you know, possessions or anything, just wandering like that. And they say, well, how are we going to get to where we want to go? She goes, oh, God will provide. And then someone would meet, they'd meet someone they hadn't seen in years or something, or, oh my gosh, oh, you know what, I wanted to, you know, I owed you some money, or, you know, whatever. And the exact fare would show up. Whatever they needed would be exactly what was needed to get the train ticket. And it went on and on and on like this, nonstop. Because she had the perfect will to help everyone spiritually. So nothing was obstructed. Never, there was no obstruction taking place, because the obstructions in are in our own will, and our loyalty to absurdity, so that we then ask for time to intervene and get in our way, or at least our belief in time is. There's no time intervening. It's just that things don't happen when they could. It's just delayed because we say, not now, I'm waiting, I'm waiting. Absurdity wants me to wait. I've got to please absurdity. Therefore, I need to wait and not have this happen right now. So I prefer to be here now. I prefer to be here now. it's a great motto. I prefer to be here now. So that just kind of blew my mind. The timing on that was just exquisite. And because I had a very positive attitude there, and I was chatting the guy up, he went out to the parking lot with me to help me. Otherwise, it never would have happened. But I was so engaging with him, engaged in a very positive, bright way, that he said, you know what? I kind of enjoy conversing with this guy. I'm going to go out to the parking lot and help him load the stuff. And that's when we saw the van, and so I started talking about it. So there's some principle here at work, actually. And I'm sure that people throughout history have been aware of this. And Christians have tried to understand this, and people from different traditions also tried to understand that there's this very positive, helpful principle at work. That ultimately helps us walk back our valuing of time entirely. Because this was like instantaneous. I was not in an attitude of no delay right now. So no delay attitude. That doesn't mean we have to rush to do things faster. It means that we rely on miracles more. And that the Holy Spirit instantly fulfills all our requests. And we may not think so because we're demanding delay. We're trying to please absurdity. So we say, well, why did it take so long, Holy Spirit? Well, the willingness was there. And when we drop our demand for delay, miracles happen for us. And this is why Jesus could heal everybody. He did not request any delay at all. He said, I'm willing for you to be well right now. I'm willing for you to be here now. I'm willing for you to be here now. And you meaning truth. I'm willing for truth to be here now. To be evident right now. I'm willing for truth to be evident right now. And his willingness was so strong that others felt it and said, yeah, you know, I'm going to have a little bit of willingness myself. And boom, leprosy's gone. It didn't send people to hospitals. Jesus didn't say, hey, you know what? Poor leper. Let me put you in a leper colony. No, he said, you're healed. Go back into society. Let no one condemn you anymore. The lame says, pick up your cushion and walk right now. Lazarus, stand up out of the grave and walk out of the grave right now. And we could say, Jesus, 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 meaning yes, 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 yes to that. Yes, we applaud that. We're in full applause mode of that. Wow. well, what are we doing here? Somebody, this truck wants to get in here. I got to let him in. I'm trying to get around him, and now they said they're going to block me because they got their blinkers on. I don't know what they're trying to do. Okay, he's getting over. Okay, it's all good. What is this about? So two lanes are blocked now. I'm going to have to, this is interesting. Tried to go in the slow lane to get around these trucks who were in the middle lane, and the truck in front of me, there's two of them, went over to the slow lane and blocked the slow lane. So I can't get past either one of them. So I'll just go in the fast lane. The Holy Spirit's telling me, stay in the fast lane of grace. Stay in the fast lane, meaning don't value time. You see, so the trucks just help us out right there. Beautiful teaching right there. Stay in the fast lane of grace. I prefer to be here now. Be well right now. Be truth. Let truth be present right now. That's the fast lane. So let's, now I'm getting past the trucks. I thank the truck for blocking me like that. Wonderful. That was a nice teaching lesson there by the Holy Spirit. This is great. I'm loving it. Just stay in the fast lane. Whoops, gotta get over here. Gotta get over to get exit this. Oh, it's getting crowded here, huh? Wow, gotta get over. See if somebody let me in. I hope so. Yep. You got to be assertive on the roads right now in terms of getting in. People don't really, they say, I don't know. They're ambivalent about it right now. I noticed that in Los Angeles driving. The cars, they pull in quick. I mean, they don't hesitate. They don't give you a chance to think about it. They just, there's room, they'll squeeze in like boom, like that. That's just the way you have to drive if it's this crowded. People, that's the problem with the slow lanes, right? And exiting into absurdity. People aren't so willing. They're struggling. They're delaying. Delay is a struggle. And we have to struggle for stuff not to happen right now. Keep in mind reality. Everything happens right now. Even our delay is happening right now. A wave of totality is happening right now. A wave of totality is happening right now in the totality. If we want to label some wave, oh, it's the wave of totality. Well, that's also in the total, one with the totality in the now. And totality isn't moving at all. There's nowhere for it to go. Where can the totality move to? So the stillness of totality is all omnipresent. It's omnipresent. Life is in the fast lane. Life in the fast lane, the real fast lane, that's where life is. It's now. So again, it's a big struggle for us to pretend that life is not in the now. That it has to do with time, space, process, and form, which is just a pretense of delay. That's it. So it is a huge struggle. We're miserable with this. How do we keep this illusion going? You know, oh my gosh, it's just like we feel so burdened, and we say, God, you gave us this terrible burden, you know, horrible hours of suffering. God didn't give us this burden. We gave it to ourselves. And it's not a real burden at all. It's just a pretense. We're pretending. It's kind of like someone pretending to be crippled. Say, God, it's so horrible, difficult to pretend to be crippled. Please, will you please help me? Please, forgive me and get rid of the... I mean, I'm so sorry I sinned against you and you crippled me. No, we didn't sin against God, and God didn't cripple us. We are pretending to be crippled because we're trying to be greater than God. So God said, well, sure, I'll help you. I'll point out that life still is in the now. I've never changed. I didn't get fooled by your crippledness. Your attempts to trick me didn't work. Thank God, right? We're just trying to fool God, actually, through our pretense. So don't say, hey, God, I'm so sorry I sinned against you, and stop punishing me. That's just reinforcing the egoic delusion of pretense. Say, God, I'm so happy to realize that this sickness is nothing but pretense, my own pretense, and that life is still entirely in the now, and therefore I can be well, I can be one with truth right now, which means I can drop all pretense right now. Thank you for reminding me of this truth. This is the approach that Jesus wants us to have with God, with truth, and that he's advocating, as are the other great teachers. Truth is true right now. All of truth is true right now, without any exception. All of truth is true right now, without any exception whatsoever. And none of absurdity is true, nor will it ever be true, no matter how much we try to please absurdity through agreeing for ever more delay. So let's live life in the fast lane, which is right now. Everything happens faster, right? What we want now is what we have right now. And we needn't be afraid of making bad choices, because we can change it instantly. If we don't like an experience, it's changed instantly. Right now. So it's very exciting to get to all this information and reinforce it. Because we say, something tells me I'm in for something real good, right? Absolutely. We're prying the icy talons of delay, you know, off of our throats here. Using a crowbar here. So we stay in the moment. We stay in the moment of grace here. The nowness. I'd rather be here now. 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 And look for the next miracle. And be open to the next miracle. Call it living in God's grace, which is the nowness of truth. And again, we need not be hung up on labels. We can be entirely ecumenical. Living in the now of God's grace. It's very ecumenical. It can apply to any tradition, right? We're living in the now of God's grace. At least we're letting it in more and more and more. Letting the evidence in. When we say letting it in, I mean it's true already, true. We're just letting the evidence in, meaning our attention is becoming more and more aware of the evidence of this fact. Everything is all grace in the now, actually. There's nothing that's not. It's just that we're pretending to delay, which is also within God's grace. God's grace is always there to bring the evidence to our attention, to all. Doesn't matter how much delay we're pretending to be engaged with. God is perfectly willing for the evidence to arise of the nowness of life. So wherever we are, we can notice that, hey, that interesting. How did that work out in my favor like that? You know, whenever we turn to grace, it's there for us. It's always there for us, because grace is always in the now. How could it not be there for us? Grace is in the now of totality. Where else could it be except right here, right now for us? Where else could it be? See, where else could it be? I just gotta get in between a Beamer and a Porsche here, and no problem. So grace is always opening a door in some way that we can relate to wherever we're at, depending on our level of pretense. But we certainly cannot keep this charade going of, hey, God, I know you're punishing me for my sins. That's the worst attitude. That shuts the door on grace entirely. Come on. That makes a mockery of God and of grace. And unfortunately, many are still trapped in that false belief system. They say, well, we're not trying to punish ourselves. Well, you know what? We think the payoff is so huge that we'll be greater than God that we're willing to pretend to be sick and then blame God for it. That we sinned against God. In other words, we harmed God, so God is angry and is punishing us, which of course means that God can be contested. So it's really just testimony, fake testimony we're using to believe that God can be contested, that perfection can be contested. All sickness, all trouble is fake evidence because we're pretending to be sick. That is, and then claiming it's real evidence. That is fake evidence. This whole world is nothing but fake evidence. Pretense evidence coming from us and then arrogantly displaced onto God in our belief and having causation to it that we did something to harm God, so God feels threatened and has to punish us. Say, that's terrible. Including harming God, including somehow we have harmed ourselves. No, pretense doesn't harm the pretender, actually. It still remains 100% pretense. Whatever it is, it's still pretense. So we have not harmed God, and we have not harmed ourselves. So where is the sin? Where is the sin? And where is the threat? And where is the anger? And where is the punishment? Where's the causation? Where's the reason? Where's the causation for the punishment? No sin? So, what must it be? It must be pretense. We must be pretending to be punished. Ah, I have this terrible affliction. Awful. Didn't come from me. Why would I want to be sick? Well, so we could pretend to be greater than God, is why. If we deny that we did it to ourselves, where else could it come from? Except from God, or some mysterious source other than God. Evolution, not coincidence, chance, just happens that, you know, has some causation other than us or God, which is, again, to say that God can be contested. Perfection can be contested. Doesn't matter how we label it, how we play this game. You know, theists or atheists, doesn't matter. It still fundamentally it means that we believe God can be contested. And since we were created perfect, the only way we can believe this is that we have to do the pretending. God's not doing the pretending, we are. Nothing else is doing the pretending for us. How can someone do pretending for us? Pretense means, inherently means that we are, someone is doing pretending. But if we're not pretending, we'd be aware that we wouldn't be sick. That we must be doing the pretending and then denying it and blaming some other source for it. Life in the fast lane. 209 cash gas right now. Wow, that must be making the Russians happy. I mean, you talk about trying to instigate war, trying to collapse the Russian economy. I mean, what are they expecting? What are they looking for, really? I I mean, the global politics is, it runs off of oil. I mean, if it's $2.09 here, cash, it's got to be under $2 the rest of the country. California usually runs about 30 cents more a gallon here. I don't pay attention to the news, so I don't know what it is. But I bet it's beneath $2. Well, that has a profound effect on the global economy. And economics is global politics. It is policy, global policy. And it can be interpreted. I mean, the war, they say most warfare in the future will be economic warfare, actually. How can it not be economic warfare is going on? A huge glut of oil. I mean, it's a slowdown of a world economy, too. But, you know, we can certainly produce a glut of oil if we wanted to. And the United States is producing a lot more, too. So there are various factors at play. But it certainly is not helping the Russian economy, is it? No. You don't want to mess with the bear. Don't mess with the bear, the Russian bear. No. Gotta get along. A little foray there into heads up. Let's keep working here as fast as possible. It's funny how people can get together and cheer for athletics. You know, athletics is often used to try to bring the world together. Say, look, we all love the entertainment of sports, and we could all cheer together. A great example is Steph Curry last night in Washington, D.C. They played the Wizards. Warriors played the Wizards. He had a bad game in New York, which was pretty shocking, because usually he plays great in New York, just because that's the mecca of basketball, and he wants to impress everybody. So he wasn't going to have two bad games in a row. And in Washington, D.C., you have the Warriors tickets are the biggest ticket in town. I mean, the prices are astronomical. I mean, this is a huge event. This is only there one time a year. And the Warriors are just one of the greatest teams in history. And Steph Curry is just a, you know, transcendent star. And so all the bigwigs are there in Washington, D.C. I mean, they're at this game. And Steph Curry just absolutely was brilliant, just on fire. And poured in 51 points, something like, 27, 28 in the first quarter. I mean, it's just couldn't miss. Didn't he just throw it up? It's in. And as he kept just pouring in the three-pointers from every possible situation, just like, I have the ball, I'm going to shoot it out here, and it's going in. And the crowd just started getting more and more into it. And finally, someone knocked the ball away, and they're scrambling for it, and he grabs it, and he's way out there. He's kind of off balance, and he just sets himself real quickly and says, what the heck? You know, just shoots it from, I don't know, 30 feet or something. Swish. And the crowd, everybody just erupted out of their seats. These are Wizards fans. You know, this is the Washington, D.C., you know, and they just said, wow, this is fun. This is fun to watch. So, you know, the sports, the hope is that we can put our differences aside and say, this is fun to watch together. You know, let's put our cultural differences aside, etc. Oh, well, you know, well, it's not working so well, is it? We tried the big sports thing, the Olympic movement, try to bring the world together through sports, and yeah, it hasn't worked so great. Maybe it's helped a little bit. But we need to keep on working on what we're doing here, and don't rely on sports to solve the world's problems. It doesn't work that way. But to look at it in a more positive light, we can be on fire too. We need to be like Steph Curry with threes and say, you know what? We're going to pick up our game. This is time to shine. He has the capacity. When it's time to shine, he has another gear, and he locks in. It's amazing. Like if it's a national televised game, it's a big time. He usually has his best games when all the pressure, all the attention is there. Raise this game up to another level, transcendent level. We can do the same thing here with grace. Walking lightly, you know, being in the fast lane here of grace. I'd rather be here now. We can be on fire in that way. And it's time to do that. It is time to do that. And this is exactly what we're doing here. And I'm just reporting live from living in the fast lane of God's grace right here, right now. I was just remarking to someone now that I have to be very, very careful what I get into, because whatever I get into, whatever I do, I want to do it very, very well. Extremely well. And so with that attitude, you have to be very careful. You have to watch yourself as to what you're getting into. You have to be very careful. So I have to watch myself like a hawk. Otherwise, it goes south in a hurry. Because I'm focused on how to be really, 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 really good at this. And if you're not paying enough attention to the content, you got to be aware of what the content, what the goal, everything else, instead of just being really good at something. Because you can end up being really good at something bad if you're not careful. That's why a lot of people get into trouble. Great people, but they're so focused on doing something really, really well, they take their eye off the prize. And so we cannot afford to take our eye off the prize, which is to drop the value of time, which is to drop absurdity. Cannot afford to take our eye off that prize. Keeping our eye on the prize is what I'm trying to do really well now. So stay focused on the goal really well. And don't worry about too much about technique or this and this and that. Alright? So it's the content. It's what is the goal that's important. Can't lose sight of it. Have to continually be focused on this. So many, many of us, all of us, will run into this problem of we can be, trick ourselves into going down bad roads, saying, well, I just want to prove that I can do this well too. And we have this feeling, I can do anything well, maybe I can do this well too. And we lose sight of where we're going. We're so engrossed in trying to do really well, we lose sight of where we're going. And the more we have this problem, the longer we'll struggle with trying to be great at it and not take our eyes off, what we're trying to be great at it. And we don't view or look at or see what the goal is, what the purpose is, where is it taking us? And then we can be led into a, black hole this way. Black hole of absurdity. We can be trying to be really great at absurdity. Really great at delay, right? So I can be a master of delay. I can do this great too. Let me show how great I am at this. I'm trying to prove that we're really spirit. I'm trying to prove. Well, proving that you're spirit, the only way to do that is to drop absurdity. And you've got, in order to do that, you can't take your eye off the goal. It's absurd to take our eye off the only goal there is, which is to drop absurdity. That would be absurdity. So if we take our eye off that goal, we're we're not being good at it at all. We're being good at something else. We're being good at being absurd. We're pretending to be absurd, actually. We're not being it. We're pretending to be absurd. Pretending to be absurd is what we're being. But actually, being is never absurd. Totality, when is totality less than totality? We draw lines across totality and say it's been separated or fragmented. Now, isn't the line that we're drawing also part of totality? Isn't that included in totality? So where's the fragmentation of totality taking place? There's a huge wave. We label the wave the wave of totality. Where is that taking place? Isn't totality omnipresent? Isn't it taking place within the omnipresence of totality? So let's get really good at preparing for this vision of totality. Seeing totality. We could think of it as sky-like. Longchenpa used the term sky-like. Totality is sky-like. It's not really the sky, but sky-like is a metaphor, I guess. If you're in a place where you see a lot of sky, it's just it's smoothed out sameness, isn't it? And the seeing of totality is really like an experiencing of it, of totality, a feeling of totality. It's not the kind of perceptual vision that, you know, we're used to, sensory vision like that. It's like an awareness of totality, really. An awareness of totality. There's this awareness that we feel, this awareness of totality. And where is the non-awareness of totality taking place? Within the awareness of totality. Always. Wow. I just talked with somebody that got some equipment I gave that wasn't working, and I said, "You fix it?" He said, "Oh, yeah." And bad this and bad that. So there was a lot of problems, a lot of stuff wrong. I said, "Oh, yeah." So he's an expert. There's a lot wrong with it. It wasn't a quick fix that an amateur could deal with. Very much similar to the world right now. This is not amateur hour in the world anymore. It's not amateur hour here anymore. I'm still an amateur, so no thank you. And so then from that, immediately there's this pack of workout people that are working out. And they're on a run. So I stop, let them go by. And I notice something. Hey, there's like a pack in front, and then a middle pack, and then a pack, one straggler in back. So I wait. And the straggler in back says, go ahead. I'll wait for you. And I gave him a chance to rest. So who was in back? Who was the straggler? Who was in back of this pack? A white male, older white male, like my age kind of, older white male. He's like, I'm tired. There's a really strain here. Okay, nice place to take a break. He said, I think I'll take a break. I said, okay. I was going to let him say, well, I was going to wave him through. I said, oh, okay, I understand. I'll go. Worked out great for him. He said, okay, I'm really tired of this nonsense. Too much trouble here. And the middle pack was sort of the youngish people. All right. Who's in the lead pack of this whole gaggle of workout people? Who was in the lead pack? Probably already know. It was the yoga girls, of course. Of course. They're leading the pack. You wouldn't have seen that in days gone by. No way. No way. Guys would have been out in front. They're not out in front. It's the yoga girls that are out in front now. So that was, again, the Holy Spirit said, take a look at this. Take a look at, wow, the Holy Spirit's really, really, I'm amping up my exercise here. It's always on right now. I mean, you don't take any time off right now. Come on. This is go time. And that straggler was actually the blessed one, because I came to my vehicle and he said, oh, go ahead. I see you've been waiting. Don't wait for me. Don't wait for me. Right? Don't wait for truth. Don't wait for truth. I prefer to be here now. And he got to rest. And maybe he's thinking, you know what? I don't really have to keep up with these folks. Let me take a break from this. Right? Because they're trying to please absurdity, are they not? Yeah. Wow. What a... The world can stand as a metaphor for where you're at and where you're going. It always does in some way. And so I just have to keep with it. It's very... Get used to it. Make it the new normal. Everything that seems to be happening seems to point out truth to me. Gives me a heads up. Everything that happens gives me a heads up. I'm in the groove. I'm in the zone. I'm Steph Curry hot. Can't miss. Maybe I miss one. Occasionally miss one, but it doesn't quench the fire, does it? No way. Coming back a little late and pour some more in. Pour some more buckets in. Wow. What a gorgeous day it is today. All sorts of plants here and there are starting to bloom. We just need El Nino to show up. I'm an amateur, talented amateur, but an amateur. And this is not amateur hour right now in the world. The world is not so... A talented amateur is in the most dangerous position of all. And they need to back off. So let me take a little break from this. And next time I engage the world, I will no longer be an amateur. Be a real professional at that point. You got to be a real professional to handle what the world, the slickness of this world. I mean, you got to be walking on air to handle the slickness. I went down to that pond. The only way to handle that pond, the slickness of that mud by that pond, was be to be floating in the air, so I'm not even touching the surface. That's the only way. The only way. Or to stay away from that pond altogether. But those who are crying out for help are positioning themselves in the jaws of catastrophe and saying, help, help. It's like they're in the jaws of a great white shark and they're all, please help, please help. Oh, look, it's so dark in here. It's so dark. Can you help us? And we try to help. We don't realize the jaws and the teeth of the shark. About ready to get in there, they snap shut. So you got to be professionally aware of what's going on, nonstop, abiding in the awareness, abiding awareness of totality to handle the slickness of this world. So for the talented amateurs, time to take a little vacation. You got to know your limitations from a pragmatic standpoint. But I can help other talented amateurs wake up to this fact, which is what I'm working on. You don't have to be a genius to know when there's a storm coming. If you've lived in the world long enough, as far as a weather storm, you know, the signs are all there. You say, I've seen it so many times, it's coming. Gets real warm and tropical. Suddenly, the breeze is coming from a certain direction. A certain type of cloud is moving in. Then the clouds, you know, cover the sky, and then the wind starts shifting, and then the wind starts getting stronger, and you just realize, hey, a front is coming in, for sure, for sure. And you don't have to wait for the rain to hit in order to take shelter. You say, let's hedge our bets, let's get shelter. And if it doesn't come in, it's all good. Win-win. But there are enough signs that are given out. It's like a wind direction. It's like advanced warning. So in this world, there's advanced warning. There's signs, advanced warning signs of attitude and patterns of attention and all that that indicate a conflict is coming, a storm is coming, trouble is coming in this world. Those are advanced indicators. So let the professionals handle. If it's a real heavy one, we get a heads up from the grace of God saying, this is too much trouble. So, and I've been preparing to sidestep it by boycotting a lot of stuff in the world, getting used to stepping aside. And the less I know about the world, the less likely I'm to engage with it at this point, right? I don't know what's going on in the world, really. It's been like 7 months of full-out boycott, except for maybe some, you know, sports scores. And so, I don't know. I'm not really attached to the mechanism, what's happening here, the trends and all this stuff. I'm just not attached to it anymore. It doesn't really matter to me. So it's like I don't even know what I'm missing. I just go play golf for a while. And when the Holy Spirit says, you know, hey, okay, time to go back, and go back to it. And people will have, attitudes will have softened up, and they'll be more interested in listening and hearing about truth. All right. It's important to keep in mind that when we make this effort to see everything as grace working out for our advantage, that clues us into what we need to be clued into, you get a lot out of your day, a lot out of it. Someone said today, are you having a lot of fun today? And I said, well, you know, you got to make your day fun. You really have to make your day fun. It's not going to just happen automatically unless we have the right attitude. So if everyone you meet, you're happy to meet them because they're going to help you out tremendously in some way. Every situation you're happy to come across is going to help you out in some way, because you're open to that and you're focused on that. Then your day is going to be fun. I'm having a wonderful day, and it's going to get better and better and better. I know the Holy Spirit is completely aware of every detail of everything, of all, and is able to, has this play of attention going. It's perfect at the play of attention. So it plays with our attention. It can help us go in that flow, and we become aware of something, and it just triggers an insight. It triggers a recognition. It becomes helpful to us. And when you're really in the zone, everything is helpful. No, there's nothing that's not. This is what the gurus tell us. There's nothing that's not grace. It is wonderful help. No such thing as something isn't. It doesn't. This is when you're really in the creative zone. When whatever you see, it's just, that reminds me of truth. That's a beautiful expression of... Ultimately, you're in the state where everything is this beautiful ornamentation of its own intrinsic spaciousness. That's what Longchenpa is helping us work towards. A flawless ornamentation of its own intrinsic spaciousness. Flawless. Everything's flawless. As Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma would say, everything is perfect. Everything is already perfect. There's only this gorgeous perfection everywhere. We can literally see it that way. And we will. I can, I will, I already am seeing it this way. Look at it like that. Practice like that. A muscle car with a tiki emblem on its gas lid there on the side. Yeah. An ominous pit bull tiki decal. That attitude of the tiki attitude, pit bull tiki attitude, says, if I'm going to bite, I'm going to bite hard and I'm going to hold on. Yep, that is. And then we're just talking about muscle cars. I was today. And, you know, I say Dodge had brought back the muscle car and somebody I was speaking with said, yeah, with a vengeance. With a vengeance. I said, wow, vengeance. Is the world in a vengeful mood? Seems like it, right? seems like all the old wounds are going to, you know, resurface. That people are getting ready for vengeance. And Jesus says, get ready for forgiveness. That's more than a different message. That's a diametrically opposite message. Got to get ready to forgive yourself for delaying in absurdity. All right? Let's see if I can... Okay. No, couldn't quite do it. All right. Got to be patient here with this traffic. There's a yoga girl. Go right past that. Just being patient, waiting for her time. Okay. Just navigating this traffic mess. It's not quite as bad as it used to be, actually. It's starting to soften up a little bit. I think a lot of people just said, we can't take it, and they left. Let's go work somewhere else. This is just hideous. I think a lot of people fled up to Washington and Oregon, and really, I was talking to people, I say, we're leaving. This is too much. Must be nice to be mobile like that and be able to make money anywhere you go. Wow. Amazing. Remember, the reduced intensity zones are free. Everything's free there because everything can just manifest there. Manifestation is groovy. And so, they don't need money. You don't need to be wealthy to go there. You don't. It's like, oh, I don't have any money. How can I go there? How can I buy a nice place? How can I, have a? You know, everything's free, gorgeous homes, gorgeous whatever. You know, it's just manifested. Remember, reduced intensity zone of valuing time. So we don't have to go through all the rigmarole of cutting lumber and planing it, distributing it, cutting it, building the houses, all this delay. Oh, it's like all process, you know, we're bound by process. We want a nice house, there's a nice house. Maybe we'll take a little time, it won't be completely instantaneous, we might be a little frightened of that. Maybe we'll just grow a house, you know, let the house grow, take shape. These little house seeds we plant and put in the ground, and you know, maybe in a couple days your house has grown. It's all right there for you. Food. Food is just there. Say, oh, okay. Or maybe it's just right there on the tree and it's easy to pick. You have a little like ramp from the tree, underneath the tree, that, and whenever you want some fruit, you know, it drops a fruit and then it rolls down the ramp right into your kitchen. Lots of different, it'll probably be fun. I think reduced intensity zone is going to be a lot of fun, actually. Different way of living. You want it to be warm, it's warm. You don't have to deal with utilities. Want some water, there's water. So no utility costs, no housing costs, no food costs. You want to travel, you just travel. If you want a vehicle, there's the vehicle. Or you can just glide along. Probably a lot of different ways to travel. I'm getting interested in this reduced intensity zone. My curiosity is peaked. Like, how is that going to be there? Wow, it's really nice. You want some fruit trees, you plant a seed, and a couple days, there's a full fruit tree there, and the fruit is blossoms in the fruit, and the fruit is ready for you. And the fruit is always full of fruit. Doesn't matter how many fruits you ask for, the new blossoms open up, and in a day or two, new fruit is ready to eat. So it's always like a superabundance of everything. The grass doesn't grow fast, and the golf course don't even have to cut it. You say, just, this is the length I want the grass to be. And then it says, okay, this is the length you got. This is the length you have. No problem. No disease, no sickness there, no pesticides, no pollution. No scarcity. So this is what we have to look forward to. No politics. What do we need politicians? No lawyers. What do we need lawyering for? Notice, what can you dispute? You want something, it's yours. You want to go to a grocery store, get a bunch of stuff, fine. Where do they get their stuff? Well, it just, they have this, like I said, a conveyor belt or something where the stuff just comes in from outside. Well, where does it come? Well, it just appears on the conveyor belt, and maybe we don't pay too much attention to that, but it just materializes. Materializes and comes into the store, and it's stocked on the shelves. You could do it that way, too. So there's a variety of intensities there, actually, you could experience. You could just materialize it for yourself, but maybe that's a little too much reduced intensity. You want a little bit of delay, right? Still valuing time a little bit. So, yeah, very nice. Okay, that concludes our excursion for the day. Hope you had a lovely time. I know I did. Now maybe I'm going to go eat something, like some macaroni salad. Maybe I can just materialize macaroni salad. That's a nice thought. I had a peach mango smoothie yesterday. That was quite good. Materialize that too. And the stuff will materialize. It doesn't have to wear out. I don't have to give any evidence of reality being contested, our will being contested. Doesn't have to wear out at all. Every day it's just shining, bright, new, wonderful, perfect condition. Or if we want to distress it, you don't want to distress, we could do that too. I don't know if we want to or not. But that distressment would be exactly the way we want it. And if we want it to be new again, it's new again, just like that. Or non-distressed. Hallelujah. Keep the effort going. Keep the intensity going.